coming up on this edition of Reel to Reel.
I'm Peggy Weber, and I'll have the story about how the church is celebrating the Year of Mercy.
A national Catholic social activist's mission to put faith into action. And Mark Giza takes a look at the latest from Hollywood. These stories and more are just ahead on this edition of Reel to Reel.
Here is your Reel to Reel host, Sharon Rullier.
Hello and welcome to Reel to Reel. Last month, Pope Francis pushed open the holy door into St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, which he said would officially open the gates of justice as the Catholic Church began the celebration of the Year of Mercy. The year, the Pope stressed, is a gift of grace that allows Christians to experience the joy of encountering the transforming power of grace and rediscovering God's mercy. Peggy Weber looks at the great spiritual opportunity this year represents for local Catholics.
The Catholic Church is a little more into a month of celebrating the Jubilee Year of Mercy. It has opened wide the special doors in Rome and here in the Diocese of Springfield. In essence, the welcome mat is being put out for all. The message of mercy is being spread far and wide in various ways. Father Warren Savage will be speaking around the diocese about mercy. He is excited about this special year.
The Pope is inviting the Universal Church to turn its attention to the gift of mercy, the need for more tenderness, love, understanding, and respect for people, a genuine desire to encounter people with a heart that is intending to dialogue with people, to confront situations where people's dignity is being disrespected, and a greater effort on the part of the church to really open its doors in a spirit of welcome.
The church is asking people to practice the corporal and spiritual works of mercy. The corporal works are to give drink to the thirsty, to clothe the naked, to harbor the harborless, to visit the sick, to ransom the captive, to bury the dead. The spiritual works of mercy are to instruct the ignorant, to counsel the doubtful, to admonish sinners, to bear wrongs patiently, to forgive offenses willingly, to comfort the afflicted, and to pray for the living and the dead. All of them present a challenge, however, some are easier to put into practice.
The more difficult works are those of the spiritual nature. They're more invisible. So it takes a little more effort to admonish someone who is doing wrong, to sit down with someone and have a conversation around some very sensitive issues like racism or sexism or homophobia or any of those tendencies or attitudes that would make me diminish another person's dignity.
Father Savage suggested that there are many wonderful ways to honor the Jubilee Year of Mercy. He said that going to confession would be a wonderful way to connect with the mercy of God.
One of the greatest gifts that the church offers is the opportunity to have a conversation with God. I don't go to confession as if I go to a golden wash or to the golden nozzle to have my sins cleansed as much as I go to confession to reconnect myself in an intimate relationship with Jesus.
Father Savage also suggested another activity for the Year of Mercy, something he learned as a young boy.
My mother was Baptist, and so I learned from my mother, my Baptist mother, the importance of reading the scriptures every day. So on a practical note, I think it's important for every Christian, no matter what denomination you come from, that you spend a little more time reading the scriptures.
He also suggested on a practical level that everyone try to do one corporal work of mercy. And he said that feeding the hungry is a great activity. There also are many and varied activities in the Diocese of Springfield. Father Savage has a special booklet for Lent with a focus on Pope Francis. He also will be speaking at a parish Lenten mission at St. Patrick's Parish in South Hadley, February 15th, 16th, and 17th. And he will participate in a Lenten seminar at Our Lady of the Blessed Sacrament Parish in Westfield, February 15th, 22nd, 29th, and March 7th. St. Mary's Parish in Westfield will hold a Year of Mercy program on February 9th and March 8th. And Assisi Hall in Holyoke will sponsor Mercy Mondays beginning January 25th from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. There are many activities, including a Year of Mercy pilgrimage from September 25th to October 6th to Italy. Father Matt Alkenbright will lead a group of pilgrims. And the Catholic Women's Club of Springfield sent each member a special Year of Mercy devotional. St. Agnes Parish in Dalton is honoring the Year of Mercy by participating in a Million Acts of Mercy program. Bishop Rozanski said that personal witness is important.
If we are able to show how much of a difference Jesus makes in our own lives, then others can see how much of a difference Jesus can make in their lives. And so Mercy, during this year, really gives us a special impetus to reach out to those who feel alienated from the church and who are just looking for that invitation to come back to practice their faith.
Father Savage echoed those sentiments.
This Jubilee of Mercy year is an opportunity, at least for the local church, the Diocese of Springfield, to take a look at itself. How can we be a better church? How can we be a better example of Jesus to everyone we encounter?
How will you celebrate the Year of Mercy? There are endless opportunities and resources. Pamphlets, prayer cards, brochures, lecture series, websites, from a parish to the diocese to the worldwide church. The opportunities are there. It's just up to you to take advantage of them.
A wonderful way to jump into the Year of Mercy is to visit the designated pilgrimage churches here in the Diocese of Springfield. They include Springfield Deanery, St. Michael's Cathedral, Springfield Hamden Central Deanery, St. Stanislaus in Chicopee, Hamden West Deanery, Sacred Heart in Feeding Hills, Hamden East Deanery, Divine Mercy in Three Rivers, Greater Holyoke Deanery, St. Teresa's in South Hadley, Hampshire Deanery, St. Elizabeth Ann Seton in Northampton, Berkshire Deanery, St. Joseph's in Pittsfield, Franklin Deanery, Blessed Sacrament in Greenfield, and the National Shrine of the Divine Mercy in Stockbridge. This year can be amazing, according to Father Savage.
It's really an opportunity to really show the world that the church loves you, wants you, welcomes you, and really wants to share the joy and mercy of God with you.
Between now and November 20th, when the Year of Mercy concludes, there will be many more programs and celebrations. But judging by how Pope Francis has made an effort to reach out to others, whether visiting the elderly or offering forgiveness, this can be a very special time in the life of the church. For Real to Real, I'm Peggy Weber.
Thanks, Peggy, and you can go to our website, iobserve.org, and click on the Year of Mercy icon for more details and dates regarding this special year. And one nationally known Catholic social activist who has been a champion for mercy for more than a quarter century visited the Diocese of Springfield recently. Jack Jezreel, the founder of Just Faith Ministries, has seen more than 40,000 people and more than 1,500 churches feed the hungry, house the homeless, and basically bring hope and possibility and mercy to those in need.
Part of our task as human beings, made in the image of God, is to love everybody, but especially the ones for whom love is not getting to them.
Louisville, Kentucky-based Jack Jezreel developed and directs the National Just Faith Ministries, a program working to get parishioners more involved in the social mission of the Catholic Church. Locally, Holy Cross Parish in Springfield, which runs a Just Faith program, hosted Jezreel, who explored Pope Francis' thoughts on how parishioners can become more involved in the world around them.
Our Catholic faith draws us into the care of all people, but especially the ones who need it most, the ones who are refugees, the ones who are fleeing wars, the ones who are impoverished.
Jezreel says many Catholics have never had much opportunity to study or be inspired by Catholic social teaching because before Vatican II, the work of the church was to be carried out by the clergy. This created a passive role for the laity. But he says after Vatican II, the model changed, calling all who are baptized Catholic to actively serve and not just in church.
The Just Faith program is a 30-week-long process, which includes learning sessions, retreats, and prayer, and community building. And upon completion, parishioners, he hopes, will be inspired to become involved in works that help and serve those most in need, which, by the way, he says, is countercultural.
People magazine might tell us that what we want to do is be upwardly mobile. But what the gospel suggests is actually that we want to be downwardly mobile, that where the action is and where Jesus goes is into the places where love often is obstructed.
Deacon Bill Toler runs the Just Faith program at Holy Cross and also serves on the National Just Faith Board of Directors. He says two successful ministries have resulted from his parish's involvement in Just Faith. Holy Cross's sandwich program, where parishioners make sandwiches for the homeless in the community, and the recently added Take and Eat program, which provides a weekend meal for the homebound. He says people who have taken part in Just Faith have been enriched.
We have the great privilege of seeing people transform. I mean, I guess that's, if the goal of the spiritual journey is transformation, we see it every week. And we see it in the ways in which people begin to change their attitudes.
And this is exactly the model of church that Pope Francis has in mind, says Jezreel.
This notion of a church that's sort of moving, that's engaged, that's having encounters. And then in the experience of the encounter, when we ask the questions, why are we doing this? Then we have an opportunity to unpack what Jesus meant in the most real of ways.
And for more information about Just Faith locally, go to iobserve.org. And still to come on Real to Real,
a Marian movement's offer of spiritual renewal in the new year. And Mark Giza looks at the latest from Hollywood.
I don't know what you're talking about.
These stories and more are still to come on this edition of Real to Real.
I know exactly what you're doing, Norm.
The Chalice of Salvation, your weekly spiritual connection. I'm Passionist Brother Terrence Scanlon, your Chalice host, inviting you to take time out of your busy days and join us Sunday morning at 10. We welcome Father William Terigny, pastor of St. Rose de Lima Parish in the Aldenville section of Chicopee, as our presider. The Chalice of Salvation, your spiritual connection, Sunday morning at 10, right here on 22 News.
Our family is made up of every race. We are young and old, rich and poor, men and women, sinners and saints. Our family has spanned the centuries and the globe. With God's grace, we started hospitals to care for the sick. We establish orphanages and help the poor. We are the largest charitable organization on the planet, bringing relief and comfort to those in need. We educate more children than any other scholarly or religious institution. We developed the scientific method and laws of evidence. We founded the college system. We defend the dignity of all human life and uphold marriage and family. Cities were named after our revered saints who navigated a sacred path before us. Guided by the Holy Spirit, we compiled the Bible. We are transformed by sacred scripture and sacred tradition, which have consistently guided us for 2,000 years. We are the Catholic Church. With over 1 billion in our family, sharing in the sacraments and fullness of the Christian faith, for centuries we have prayed for you and our world, every hour of every day, whenever we celebrate the Mass. Jesus himself laid the foundation for our faith when he said to Peter, the first pope, "You are rock, and upon this rock I will build my church." For over 2,000 years, we've had an unbroken line of shepherds, guiding the Catholic Church with love and truth in a confused and hurting world. And in this world filled with chaos, hardship, and pain, it's comforting to know that some things remain consistent, true, and strong, our Catholic faith, and the eternal love that God has for all creation. If you've been away from the Catholic Church, we invite you to take another look. Visit CatholicsComeHome.org today. Ours is one family, united in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We are Catholic. Welcome home.
Butcher, baker, candlestick maker, I didn't care what they grew up to be, as long as they were happy. To give up marriage and children just seems like too much to walk away from.
He seems to think he's making a real difference in people's lives, and he's so happy. Isn't that what's most important?
I never would have imagined our son as a Catholic priest.
On this week's Real Culture, a fantastic action film, a great family film, and one movie I wish I did not see at all. Let's take a look at this week's Real Culture. 13 Hours. What a movie. What a story. The film's main subject is the 2012 attacks on the U.S. consulate in Benghazi, Libya, and how these brave men put their lives on the line for their friends, and really for all us Americans. Now, the story was told with the help of five survivors who let their hearts and souls run free in this gripping film. Okay, I will be honest, it's a film that contains salty language and really tough scenes, but it's a great film. And a real wake-up call.
They were coming in, we're on property.
13 Hours just tells the minute-by-minute story of what happened that night. Try to get what we all did and what we went through.
We as a team decided that the story that wasn't being told out there was what actually happened that night, and so we felt compelled to make sure the story gets out there the right way. It's not about the politics, it's the story of what happened on the ground.
Norm of the North. What a great family film. A perfect film for a cold, snowy day. The plot is simple. A polar bear does not like to hurt people. He just wants to be your best friend. But his life will change when a builder wants to take over the Arctic and build houses and destroy his beloved life. So he sneaks to New York City to try to stop it all before it's too late. Okay, we're not talking Oscar-winning film here, but we are talking about fun for a family on a cold winter night. What could be better?
Please, I know exactly what you're doing, Norm. You're saving the Arctic. You're home. So I'm thinking, maybe we can work together, and you can save my home in the process.
Like you and me, I tell you, enough is getting over now.
Be honest, what's your plan here?
Well, Mr. Green wants to use me to sell the Arctic, and I'm going to use the Arctic to save it.
Exactly. You have to rally the public so that they love you, wait for your moment, and turn them against Green. Use his own plan to defeat him. But the key is to make sure you time your moment just right when the public loves you the most.
And please don't waste your time on the film Ride Along 2. It's such a bore. I was asleep before the end, praying it was all a bad dream. Kevin Hart and Ice Cube are back in a bad version of the first film, which was, for the most part, very funny. No such luck here. Now, it's a stakeout film where Hart plays a rookie cop and Q plays a detective. They're funny. The script is not. So save your money on better films, because better films are coming.
Get to the north hallway and climb out.
Ain't nobody say nothing to me about getting out of the window two stories up.
Lamberger.
Yeah?
I ain't never had one of them. Let me see.
Oh, my God!
What kind of cheese is that?
Manchego cheese.
Manchego?
You couldn't tell me that yet, alligator?
Look, I dropped the ball on that. I won't lie to you.
Alligator!
And you can see my reviews, as well as read other movie reviews provided by the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops online at iobserve.org. That's iobserve.org.
And I just returned from Hollywood, from the Critics' Choice Awards, where I'm a voting member of the BFCA. I got to meet such Oscar winners as Mary Steenburgen, Angelica Houston, and Helen Mirren, and this year's Oscar nominee, Bryan Cranston, for Trumbo. But my most exciting person I met that night was young Jacob Tremblay from the movie Room. What a fantastic night. Special thanks go out to our president, Joey Berlin, and Sarah Voihees, who's in charge of membership. It's a night I will not forget. For Real Culture, I'm Mark Giza, and I'll see you at the movies.
You are watching Reel to Reel, your window on the world around you. Here again is your Reel to Reel host, Sharon Rullier.
Well, it's January, and to mark the new year, many of us are making resolutions to eat right and exercise more. And during this year of mercy, it can also be a good time to vow to get more spiritual exercise. Peggy Weber returns now to tell us about a special movement dedicated to Mary that offers a wonderful opportunity for prayer and growth.
The 100th anniversary of a Marian movement that is known around the globe was celebrated in the Diocese of Springfield. Founded in 1914, the Schoenstatt movement has become one of the most popular Marian devotions in the world. Locally, devotees of the movement and parishioners of Our Lady of the Blessed Sacrament Parish in Westfield gathered for a special mass marking the centennial. The Schoenstatt movement was founded October 18, 1914, by a young Palatine priest named Father Joseph Kentenich. He gathered seminarians together in prayer, asking them to make a covenant with the Blessed Mother that would help them to live a holy life and foster a devotion to Mary. The Schoenstatt movement was formally approved by the Catholic Church in 1964. Father Dan Pakalik says that devotion to Mary is a central part of the Catholic faith.
The devotion to Mary is such a part of our Catholic faith, and in the Schoenstatt movement, as I understand it, developing a real relationship with Mary, because she is the mother of Jesus, and knowing that by growing closer to her, you grow closer to Jesus. The covenant of love that is part of the Schoenstatt community is a very important devotion. It's a consecration that members make to Mary and to Jesus.
Today, there are more than 200 replica shrines around the world. And the Westfield chapter owns one of those altars. In 2013, Father Dan agreed to house the altar in the church for a year. This was the first time in the movement's history that a Schoenstatt shrine was housed in a church.
We've had the altar here in the church for the last year, and we're celebrating today the closing of that year. So it is a more somber day in that the particular image of Mary is leaving the church. But being a Marian parish, we certainly know that Mary always dwells with us.
Bridget Malloy, who brought the Schoenstatt message to Massachusetts more than 50 years ago, says she greatly appreciated the gesture by Father Dan to allow the altar to be placed in the church for the centennial year.
It was beyond my wildest expectation, out of the blue. I cannot tell you the joy when I walked in here and saw the shrine.
Consecrating oneself to Mary, according to Bridget, involves making what is called a covenant of love, a commitment to Mary and Jesus. As part of the 100th anniversary, participants in Westfield and around the world renewed their covenant of love while encouraging others to become involved. Sister Georgina Ramirez, a Schoenstatt Sister of Mary, who resides at a Schoenstatt house on Staten Island, New York, told Reel to Reel that she was enthralled with the covenant of love as soon as she heard about it.
It was such a beautiful idea. I really fell in love with it. So I decided to make my covenant of love with the Blessed Mother. After my covenant of love, I also decided to become one of the sisters because I wanted to dedicate myself completely to her.
Sister Georgina says dedication to Mary and Jesus through Schoenstatt allows for many graces to be bestowed.
This movement wants to bring a movement of grace into the whole Catholic Church and the world. Nowadays, people don't value graces anymore. We are very much interested in material things. And grace, you know, we have given like a second place or even a third or fourth, who knows?
In the early 1960s, Bridget lived in Milwaukee with her husband and young children. In her parish church there, on display, was a large mosaic of the Schoenstatt image, known as the Blessed Mother, Thrice Admirable.
She's admirable as the daughter of the Father. She's admirable as the mother of the Son. And she's admirable as the spouse of the Holy Spirit. So she's three times admirable.
While at the parish in Milwaukee, Bridget met Father Kentenich and quickly became very involved in the Schoenstatt movement. But shortly thereafter, the family moved to Massachusetts. In the early 1970s, Bridget had a chance encounter with Linda Burrell, who soon became the first woman in Massachusetts to enroll in the movement. Linda still encourages people to consider making a covenant with the Blessed Virgin Mary.
That's the core of the movement. Everything else is secondary, to make that covenant with the Blessed Mother. And a covenant is so beautiful because this is God's way. He chose the method of covenant throughout salvation history.
Linda, a lifetime parishioner at Blessed Sacrament, spoke to the congregation about the movement and encouraged them to foster a closer relationship with Mary by joining the movement. Today, Bridget lives in Agawam and belongs to St. John the Evangelist Parish there. She says that while so very many graces come from this covenant with the Lord, she knows that hardships are also part of every life. But Bridget says staying closer to the Lord allows people to handle hardships.
So first thing in the morning, I make my dedication and one to the Heavenly Father. And then we go about the day. We promise, we ask always, how can you use me today? And please make me alert to what you want me to do. So we live out of that those dedication.
Linda says that being so dedicated to her Catholic faith, and particularly Mary, has helped her through many trials and tribulations, including the death of her husband after his long battle with cancer.
Going through all these events, I don't believe that I could have gone through it with the spirit that I had without the Blessed Mother, you know, behind me and supporting me. And as I said today in my talk, that she gives us what we need. She knows who we are personally and then gives us what we need. And I did make it through those awful events, and here I am. But thanks be to God, and thanks to Blessed Mother and the many graces that she gives.
Following the Mass at Blessed Sacrament, the shrine was dismantled and is now only partially reconstructed at a modest home that members own near the parish, called a movement house. Members are looking to raise the roof of the home's garage, literally. They plan to raise funds to renovate the garage, removing the roof and making room for the full-size altar there so that it can be continually on display. Reporting for Real to Real, this is Peggy Weber.
Thanks, Peggy. It's wonderful to learn more about the Schoenstatt movement and its more than 100 years of devotion. And for this week, that's Real to Real. Thanks for watching. And perhaps fittingly enough during these winter days, a warm reminder that Catholic Communications is sponsoring a pilgrimage to Mexico to the Shrine of Our Lady of Guadalupe this October. For more information on this trip or our 2017 pilgrimage planned to Fatima, log on to our website, iobserve.org. There you will also find the latest news on the Catholic Church locally and around the world. That's iobserve.org. And also, please friend us on Facebook. We are at Catholic Communications. And join me again next week at this same time for another edition of Real to Real, your window on the world around you. See you then.
Real to Real is a production of the Catholic Communications Corporation, funded in part by the annual Catholic Appeal and the support of you, our faithful viewers,